Hare Krishna. I'd like to welcome all of you all to this two-day seminar on Ramayana in the Game of Life, titled as Stand Strong. As the subtitle here says, do you have the courage to face your fears? So throughout these 2 days of the discussion on the Ramayana, this is going to be something that is central to this the two-day seminar, dealing with our fears. So hopefully, for the inconvenience that you are going through sitting here in such a situation, you'll get something valuable that might be life-altering for you, and it might really help you see life as well as our scripture, specifically the Ramayana, in a very different light. How many of you all here have attended a Ramayana, the Game of Life seminar in the past? Put up your hand. Okay, so it's half of you all. So for those who have attended, you know my style. And for those who not, I'll just quickly explain to you what my style is of presenting the Ramayana, so that you can be in sync with what we're going to do. So essentially, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to speak the story of the Ramayana in a sequence. I'm specifically focusing on one section of the Ramayana, which is known as the Kishkindha Kand. That's the book that all of you all have received, Stand Strong. It is the fourth book of the Ramayana, the Kishkindha Kand. Actually, the excitement of the Ramayana begins here. So for those who have come for the first time, you're at the right time, Because so far there's been a lot of crying and a lot of this and that, So it's sometimes painful, the first section of the Ramayana. But from here onwards, the monkeys come. And whenever the monkeys come in, the excitements begin, So you are at the right time. So this book will lead up to the Sundara Kand, which is the most important part of the Ramayana, which I am yet to begin writing. So I'm going to cover in the next 2 days only half the book, the first 5 chapters of the book. Every book has 9 chapters, typically, because the number 9 is connected with Lord Ram. Ram was born on Navami, Ram Navami. So every chapter of every book of the Ramayana is going to be 9 chapters only. And typically, the last chapter is the smallest chapter, So this is a style that I have kept consistently in the first 4 books. And the way in which I do these seminars is, first half of the book I do as a 2-day seminar. And the second half of the book I'll be doing as another 2-day seminar sometime in the future. Couple of months down the line, you can keep watch for it and you can attend the second part of it. So this section, this part of this, these 2 days is going to be the episode starting from Ram entering Kishkindha all the way up to the killing of Vali. That's what these 2 days is going to be. I'm sure all of you all would have heard something about the story of the Ramayana and something about this section of the Ramayana. But I can tell you for sure, when you all leave tomorrow evening, you will be convinced that you don't know Ramayana at all. Generally, that's the guarantee I give people whenever they come to hear Ramayana seminars. You'll be convinced that you don't know Ramayana at all. I can guarantee you. So if that happens, that's a success of the seminar. Because these scriptures are so deep and they have so much wisdom in them. Unfortunately, a superficial reading and a superficial hearing just doesn't give us anything. It's like, just a hovering around the jar of honey, So what we're going to do is actually dip into the honey the next 2 days. So the style in which I'll be presenting the seminar is a very simple style, but it's a very interesting style. I will just show you all some images which will show you what the style is, and then we will start actually the whole process. So whenever you find a black box here, that's the storyline. So whenever you find images with a black box, that's a storyline of the Ramayana. And whenever you find images with the blue box, that is a lesson. So you will find these black box and blue box coming alternately. And that's how you understand that now I'm speaking the story of the Ramayana, and then suddenly I speak a lesson from the Ramayana. That is the style in which the whole seminar is going to be. Having said all that, let's begin. Fasten your seatbelts. Get ready to take off. The monkey army, the whole Kishkinda, everyone flies. So it's, I welcome you all into the world of Ramayana. I have been swimming, diving, you know, and floating in the world of the Ramayana for the last few years. More than writing these books and more than giving these seminars, for me on a personal level, these Ramayana experience has been something that has changed my life personally. My appreciation, my love for the scriptures as well as for the Supreme Lord has definitely, you know, gone much deeper than what it was. Just because, you know, you just hang around with the scripture for such a long time, it helps. So there are many levels of understanding the scripture. One level of understanding is reading it. The second level of understanding the scripture is speaking whatever you read. The third level is writing it. So when you write it, you have to know every inch and every corner of it, you know. And for me, that's the best, that's the most important thing that has happened to me. Whether the books become bestsellers, whether the books are read by millions of people, it doesn't matter to me. I have gained on a personal level. And this is what Kamba Muni, when he writes his introduction to the Kamba Ramayana, which is a Tamil version of the Ramayana, he says that he considers Valmiki Ramayana to be like an ocean of milk. Unlimited amount of milk. I mean, just imagine there's an ocean of milk, you know. And Kamba Muni, he considers himself to be a cat. And if a cat goes in front of an ocean of milk, how much milk can the cat drink? You know? Just a little. So if Kamba Muni considers himself to be a cat, I would consider myself to be like an ant. And one drop of that milk is enough to drown an ant. So that's what I've been doing in the last 4 or 5 years, drowning in the Ramayana and enjoying myself thoroughly. So having said all that, let's begin with Stand Strong. Fears is there in everybody's life. Everyone has different types of fears. It is not because you fear you avoid things, but because you avoid things, it becomes your fear. That which you do not face, it starts controlling you. And that which controls you causes great fear inside you. When you face your fears, the fear gets destroyed. But generally, most people, they don't like to face their fears. The reason people don't like to face their fears is because somewhere inside, there is something you have to hide from the world. When you have nothing to hide from the world, there is nothing to fear. But generally, everyone has something inside them which they want to hide from the world. And that dishonesty creates certain amount of fear in life. Fear is induced because you're not ready to face a particular situation. And you're not ready to face a particular situation because you don't have the courage to be honest. So there are two types of fears. The first type of fear is the fear of facing something. The second type of fear is the fear of excellence. So when you, the first type of fear, which is the fear of facing something, it's a negative type of fear. And the fear of excellence is a positive type of fear. What is the meaning of fear of facing something? So essentially, whenever we come across an obstacle or problem in life, and we are scared of it, we are afraid of it, I don't want to face it because I feel that what will happen, what will be the consequence of me facing it? So that's the first type of fear. It's a very negative type of fear. The second type of fear is fear of excellence. That means I am already successful. Now the fear is, will I be able to keep up this success? That also causes fear. Like somebody who is always failing in exams. Now what fear he has? There's nothing to fear. Because again, he fails, it doesn't matter, you know. But for somebody who has been always getting first rank, This is great fear when the results come. Why? If you get second rank, big problem, you know. This is not the fear of excellence. So, generally, whenever we have a fear in our life, we need to remember that either we learn to face it ourselves or we have faith in somebody who has faith in us. This book is going to talk about many people dealing with their fears. I'm going to share a story. And interestingly, this story exactly represents the story that I'm going to speak about from the Ramayana. And, you know, I mean, this is quite an interesting way of seeing life. And I was thinking that every story that is there in the world, every story or every concept that is there in the world has some story in the Ramayana that we can relate to in our personal lives. Here is a story that will help you all think about what I'm trying to say. One time, there was a girl who complained to her father that her life is miserable. And she was completely in a great anxiety and she had no idea how to handle all the fights and all the struggles that she's going through in her life. And in her life, she felt that every problem leads to another problem. I'm sure many of you will be having such phases in your life where you're going through problem after problem. And there seem to be no end only to it. So her father took this girl to the kitchen. This fellow was a chef. So he decided to teach her in his style. So he put three containers having water on three stoves. And he heated them up. So the water began to boil. In the first container, he put a potato. Put it in. In the second container, he put an egg. And in the third container, he put coffee seeds. And he left it to boil for 20 minutes. So this girl is crying about all her problems and, you know, she's talking about how she's stressed and all that. And this fellow is cooking over here, you know. So she was thinking how insensitive he is, you know. He's just not listening to what I'm saying. After 20 minutes, this fellow put off all the three stoves. And he told this girl, he removed each of the items. He put it on the table. He removed the potato, put it on the table. Removed the egg, put it on the table. And then he allowed the coffee to remain in a cup. Then he told her, touch the three of them. Experience the three of them. So she touched the potato. It was hard. Now it had become very soft. Your finger can just pierce in. The egg, he made her remove the shell of the egg. But inside it was hard now. And the coffee, naturally, he made her drink it. He asked her, what do you learn from these three things? She said, I have no idea what you're trying to tell me. He said, this is exactly what life is all about. All the three were put in the exact same situation of life, which is boiling water, you know. Now, all the three were apparently put in the same situation, but look at the way they reacted to the same situation. The first one, the potato, was hard in the beginning, but when it was put into troubled waters, it became soft. So he said that the first category of people who seem to be tough, but when they come across problems in life, when they're thrown into problems in life, they become soft and they start crying. They can't handle themselves, you know. Too soft to handle it. The second category of people are like this egg. They seem to be soft in the beginning. They seem to be delicate in the beginning. But when they're put in problems, they become hard. Problems don't weaken them, it strengthens them. But many times, these hard people are the ones who actually become insensitive when they come across tough times in life. They can face it, but everyone around them suffers because they just become so hard-hearted. The problems don't affect them, but the problem is that they become insensitive. And the third category of people, he said, are like these coffee beans. They enter into the problem, but they change the flavor of the problem. They make the problem itself different, you know. And such people actually enhance life. So in the Ramayana, there are three people that we are going to talk about throughout these 2 days. The first category of people are people who, when they come across problems in life, when they're thrown into problems, they become soft and they actually cry. Miserable. In the Ramayana, we find the first category of people is represented by Sugriva, the Vanara. So Sugriva, you'll find throughout the next 2 days, we're going to discuss a lot about Sugriva, you know. And you'll find this man, this Vanar, this monkey, man, whatever you call it, this personality, just melting in front of the problems. He goes crazy whenever he comes across problems in his life. And he's just not able to handle it. The second category of people who become hard during the problems, become insensitive when they come across problems, is represented by Vali in the Ramayana. And Vali represents those people, no matter what problem they come across in their life, they know how to deal with it. They're so tough. They're so powerful. But through the process of becoming hard, they actually also become hard-hearted. They become highly insensitive towards people and towards people whom they love and who love them. And the third category of people is like Hanumanji. These are people who come across problems in life, but they are the ones, when they come across problems, they change the taste of the story. The presence of people like Hanumanji is a gift in today's world. Why is Hanuman worshipped? Why do we have so many temples of Hanuman in the world? The reason is because this person represents those people who blend themselves and change the taste of the story. Hanumanji represents those category of people who actually know how to live a life for the sake of the world. You will not even find one story of Hanuman where Hanuman got anything for himself. I mean, I can bet you, I've written an entire book on Hanuman, and I've, you know, read hundreds and thousands of stories of Hanumanji. And I've not come across even one single story where Hanuman has got any benefit. This is the life of people like Hanuman, who know how to blend themselves and change the taste of the story. Hare Krishna. So this is the introduction to Stand Strong. Before we begin, offer a small prayer to Valmiki Muni, the original author of the Ramayana. Kujantam Rama Rameti Maduram Madurakshram Aruya Kavita Shakam Vande Valmiki Kokilam Valmikir Muni Simhasya Kavita Vanicharinaha Shrunva Rama Katanatam Kona Yanti Parangatim. So I'm taking you all to the mountains of Kishkindha. This is a place where all the action is going to begin. The scene is there are four monkeys on four different corners of this one hill in Kishkindha, which is known as the Rishimukha Mountains. And something is going to happen. So there are four monkeys, Nala, Neela, Taru, and Sugriv. Sugriv is the leader among these four, these three. And Nala, Neela, and Taru, they are guarding Sugriv. Because Sugriv is in a particular situation in his life where his life is in danger. So, at one particular day, Nala, who is standing on top of a watchtower, on top of the tallest tree in Kishkindha, he starts shouting and panicking, and he starts running at an emergency. He jumps off from the top of the watchtower, starts running at great pace. He needs to give a message. Something critical has happened in Rishimukha Mountains. So as Nala is running towards Sugriv, Neela, who's on another edge of the mountain, of the Rishimukha Mountain, he also sees the same thing. And he starts jumping. So when he jumps, he lands straight on top of an elephant. But Neela is not an ordinary monkey that we see in Vrindavan or we see in, you know, in India. Neela is a huge monkey. And he's so powerful and so huge that when he jumps on the elephant crashes practically dies. So Neela starts running towards Sugriv. And seeing Neela and seeing Nala run, Taru, the third monkey, who is supposed to be watching the airways, he also starts running towards Sugriv. And all three of them come running at a great pace, fall in front of their master Sugriv. And Sugriv is doing something very interesting. This is the introduction of Sugriv in the Ramayana. Just see how each character in the Ramayana, when they're introduced, their character and personality is very visible and clear. You know, Sugriv is sitting on a rock with his hand inside, you know, holding his face, and his eyes are down and he's sad. This is typically the people, the kind of people who, when they come across problems in life, they don't know anything but cry. So he says, I am dead. All hope is gone now. Now nothing can happen to me, you know. I'm sure you recognize these words, right? Many people, I often, you know, when people come with problems to me, I often hear this. Now nothing, kuch nahi ho sakta hai mera, you know. Nothing can happen to me. I'm dead, you know. Everything is finished. So Sugriv, he immediately understands, even before these three people tell him what the problem is, he knows what the problem is. He tells all three of them, I am dead. They have not even told him what the problem is. He is himself telling what the problem is. You know, so he has not seen the problem. But just by looking at the way they are running, he understands what the problem is. Sugriv was able to see the problem even when he can't physically see it. This is what is known as fear. The problem is Sugriv's brother, Vali. Vali and Sugriv have become bitter enemies. They're going to kill each other literally. Sugriv is running away from his brother and he's hiding on this mountain. And these three other monkeys are keeping a watch for Vali. And as soon as he sees these three people running towards him, he understands he's in trouble. Success embraces those who intensely focus on the goal and at the same time monitor all the challenges in achieving that goal. The monkeys, they kept one eye on Sugriv, their master, and one eye on the threat that was visible in front of them. Actually, what had happened was, the three monkeys had seen Ram and Lakshman on the bottom, on the base of the mountain. And they assumed that Ram and Lakshman are Vali's spies, come to kill Sugriv. And in that panic, they come running towards Sugriv without even finding out who they are. They just come panicking, saying that you're in trouble. Sugriv was very powerful in the body, but very weak in the mind. A weak mind is like a bacteria that causes an infection to a huge body. You know, this bacteria is very tiny, but it can collapse a huge body. So similarly, a weak mind is always, the mind is supposed to be powerful, but what is the bacteria that can collapse a mind? It's called self-doubt. You start doubting yourself only. You start doubting your own abilities. And therefore, Sugriv was in great fear. Fear and love both result in something very interesting. Both result in seeing presence in absence. When somebody is in great love, when that person is absent, he feels that person's presence. When somebody is in great fear, same thing. The cause of fear is absent, but you feel it around you, you know. Typically, when you go into a dark room, there is nothing there. But you always feel something is there, you know. Something is there to trouble you. Something is there to haunt you. Something is there to, you know, destroy you. The nature of fear is even in its absence, you find its presence. That's exactly the nature of love also. Even in one's absence, you find the person's presence. Patanjali, in his Yoga Sutras, he talks about five things that typically every human being deals with. These are five challenges that a human being has to overcome. The first challenge is avidya, Avidya means wrong perceptions of life. So, in typical Vedic parlance, it is called as Maya. Maya, Srila Prabhupada defines as that which does not exist, that which is not. So, avidya means that it is not there, but you find it there. Avidya is typically like a mirage in a desert. The mirage doesn't exist, water doesn't exist, but you find it existing. So, avidya, when you see it from a material point of view, it's about pleasures. You have something that promises you pleasure, but actually, there is no pleasure there. It's all advertisement. Every advertisement in the world is actually avidya in action, basically, you know. Any advertisement in the world, whatever they advertise, whatever they promise you, it doesn't exist. But it exists in your perception. This is known as wrong perceptions, mal perceptions. This is known as avidya. Avidya can be countered by knowledge, jnana. The second thing that Patanjali talks about is asmita. Asmita means egoism. So here is the adulteration of the supreme consciousness or higher consciousness. It adulterates and becomes into I-ness. It becomes individuality, me, mine. And people who are having asmita or egoism at a great level, such people, they have huge amounts of conditionings that take a lot of time to go away. So we're going to talk about ego quite a bit in the next two sessions, especially because we are going to be deciphering and decoding the character of Vali, which is centered around the false ego. And essentially, avidya and asmita, that means ignorance or malperception, wrong perception, and ego leads to two other things. The third thing is known as raga. Raga means attachments. It also means indulgences. So raga means, raga leads a person to great attachments. And attachment leads a person to do anything too much. Like for example, over-entertainment. Jio. People are just going crazy about free internet, you know, whatever it means free, you know. If people are just going crazy about having too much internet, watching movies one after another, what you would watch in 3 months, you watch in 3 days, you know. When you have access to too much data, what do you do with it? You just feel that I need to exploit it to the max. And the natural result of that is indulgence. So such people opt for over-entertainment. Such people drink beyond measure, international flights, free liquor, you know. Indians go crazy. They have no idea how to handle themselves, you know. Everything is free, you know. And then the air hostess has to come and tell them, you know, enough, this is the limit. You reach the upper limit of it, you know. Shopping beyond your means. People go crazy. Everything is on EMI now, you know. Everything is available. Drop of the hat, you get it. But you keep paying for years together. So essentially, these are examples of raga or too much attachment, too much indulgence. So, avidya and asmita, wrong perception and the ego leads to first thing is raga, which is attachment. And the exact opposite of raga is dvesha, which is aversion. Aversion, on the other hand, makes you miss many opportunities in life. One bad experience, and you say, I don't want to do it again. You know? Like there are so many people who hate Chinese food, you know. Why? One bad experience, probably. I have a friend of mine who hates bananas. Hates to the core of his heart. Now, I mean, why would you hate Chinese and why would you hate bananas? One bad experience and I just... And there are some people who hate sadhus. One bad experience and that's all, you know. So, the opposite of raga is dvesha. Dvesha is aversion. I don't want it at all, you know. So that means when we don't have the right perception of life and when we have great ego, that leads us to attachments and that leads us to aversions. And both attachment and aversion lead us to the fifth thing, which is known as fears, which is known as abhinivesha. Abhinivesha means fears. It also means insecurities. So the word abhinivesha literally means clinging on to something, holding on to something very tightly, clinging on to life, fear of death, you know. So everyone has different types of fears which lead them to cling on to something very intensely. When fear of the unknown becomes fear of the less known, then fear has already lost its power on you. So that means if you have little knowledge, fear begins to lose its grip, basically. So the more there is unknown factor, the more the fear is intense. And the slowly, as the unknown factor keeps going down, the fear starts going down. So what is fear? When you expand fear, it is false evidence accepted real. That's what fear means. So that means, if you have to kill a lion, what do? How do you kill a lion? The first thing is face it. If you run away from the lion, what is the chance you will kill a lion? There's no chance. If you face it, it's a good chance the lion will kill you, but it is also a possibility you might kill the lion. But without you facing the lion, there is no chance only you will kill the lion. So essentially, even if you have to lose some blood in the process, the only chance of you killing a lion is facing it. Lion represents all the fears that we have in life. Whenever we have any fear in life, fear of water. I personally have great fear of water, you know. How do you handle that fear? Jump into the water. There's no way, you know. But I comfortably stay away from water. I try my best to stay as far away from water as possible, except in the shower, of course. You know. Any water body, it gives you a lot of fear, especially because if you had a bad experience in the past. So similarly, everything that gives you fear, if you want to deal with that fear, what do? Face it. Most people love to die in installments. Rather than facing what they fear, they love to die in installments, small installments, little by little, little by little. I don't mind dying, but I don't want to die at once, you know. So this is what fear does to you. It kills you little by little. When you avoid fear, when you avoid what you fear, it grows. And when you face what you fear, it goes. And therefore, the choice is us. Go ahead in spite of fear. Which means there's a good chance that you may one day overcome it. So that which you do not face controls you. And that which controls you causes fear in you. And therefore, fear actually is a protector. Because fear, it gives you a message. It's not a weakness. It's a message. And when we use fear as a guide, it helps you understand, it helps you prepare for a challenge. And most people use fear as an excuse. Rather than looking at fear as a guide, rather than looking at fear as a messenger, you start looking at fear as an excuse. Why? I don't want to face something. And therefore, here we find this part of the Ramayana, Kishkindha Kand, starts with Sugriva in great fear. And he is fearful of something he doesn't want to face. And what is he fearful of? He is fearful of Ram and Lakshman. So here, we just saw the scene on top of the mountain, top of Rishimukha mountain. Now we are going to see a scene on the bottom of the mountain. Now, we saw the perception of Sugriva on top of the mountain, Sugriva and the three monkeys. We saw What they saw below gave them great amount of fear and they're shivering. And actually what is the scene below is totally different. That's what we're going to see today. Now, Ram and Lakshman were in the bottom of the mountain, the Rishimukha mountain. It is a place which is known as Pampa Sarovar. And this is a small lake. Actually, it's a big lake. It was created by Matanga Rishi. And he created this lake, the Pampa Sarovar, by invoking the seven oceans. And while Ram is around the vicinity of the Pampa Sarovar, he actually starts having memories of Sita. Sita has been abducted by Ravan. We have already seen that in the last seminar, Sita being kidnapped. So now everything Ram sees reminds him of Sita. He sees a lotus. He remembers Sita's beautiful lotus-like face. He sees a black tulip. He remembers Sita's eyes. He sees a fish. He remembers Sita's sidelong glances. He gets very angry and throws a stone into the lake. And the ripples that the stone creates in the lake, it feels to Ram like his heartbeat. You know, heartbeat is trying to send a message to, you know, Sita. Sita, the center of his heart, is missing. So as Ram is crying and lamenting, feeling so bad about Sita not being with him, the birds all around are chattering like anything. So much noise, so many birds are, you know, creating all these noises. Ram is thinking, they are talking so many things except the most important thing about where Sita is. He's thinking that these are all like chatterboxes, you know, just gossiping on and on and on. These are like selfish people who are unempathic towards other people's tribulations. You know? I mean, you'll find that typically when you go to a funeral, in the funeral, you'll find people gossiping about business and about cinema and about, you know, what this person did and what that person did. I mean, how can you be so unempathetic, right? So Ram was feeling all these birds are not able to understand my pain, you know. He saw peacocks dancing. Generally, when peacocks dance, that would be the highlight of your day. But today, as he's seeing peacocks dancing, he's thinking that these peacocks are dancing because their peahens are with them. But they're not able to see, no Rakshasa has stolen their peahen, you know. And then he sees the peacocks having thousands of these eyes. You know, peacocks have these feathers which look like eyes. And he thinks that these peacocks have thousands of eyes with which they can look at their beloved. But I have two eyes, but I can't see my beloved. And he starts thinking, what is the point in they having so many eyes if they can't tell me where Sita is, you know. So Ram is having great lamentation about what's happening in his life. Sita is missing. And he shares his sorrows with Lakshman. He tells him that my life is simply because of my bad karma. All the miseries I'm going through. First of all, I lost my opportunity to serve. I lost my kingdom. Then I lost my greatest wealth, my father. Then I lost my life itself, Sita. He says, in the beginning, there was a day when I had both Rajya Lakshmi and Bhagya Lakshmi. He was supposed to be the king. And he had Sita by his side. And then I lost Rajya Lakshmi. I said, doesn't matter. I at least have Bhagya Lakshmi with me. But now I lost Bhagya Lakshmi also. He said, who can be more unfortunate than me? He says, I have become like a beggar, having nothing. He says, when I go back, what will I tell my father-in-law, Janak Maharaj? I did big, big things, broke that huge Shiva Dhanush and, you know, got Sita. And now, with a stupid mistake of mine, I lost her. What am I going to go and tell my father-in-law, you know? So he says, what will I go and tell my mother, Kaushalya? How will I face the citizens of Ayodhya? So he says, I can't blame anybody for what I'm going through except my own condition, my own past actions. Interestingly, look at Ram's mindset. In spite of him suffering, he's not asking why it is happening to me. What he is saying? It is happening because I have done something wrong in the past. This is the greatness of, you know, great personalities. They don't ask the question why it is happening to me. They know the answer. The answer is very clear, but nobody wants to face it. Why? To face it, you have to have honesty. Here, something interesting happens in the Ramayana. Lakshman has many roles in the Ramayana. Generally, Lakshman does the role of being a servant, being a, you know, caretaker, being a helper, being a younger brother, like that. But in some places in the Ramayana, Lakshman does the role of being an advisor. In every relationship, you need to have multiple roles. And sometimes, you have to upgrade your role. Most of the times, you can be in the receiving end, where you receive advice, where you receive guidance, where you receive care, affection. But there are some times, you need to upgrade your role and start giving care, giving advice, you know, giving affection. Here, in the Ramayana, we find Lakshman doing that. He tells Ram that anything that is done too much is bad. He tells Ram, too much crying is bad. Can you imagine? Somebody is advising Ram, you know. He's telling Ram, don't cry too much. Don't lament too much. Excessive lamentation is bad. Actually, excess of anything is bad. When there is too much fear, excess of fear leads to rebellion. And when people are pushed down too much, you know, every revolution that has taken place is because of too much fear. When you create too much fear, people rebel against you. Excess indulgence leads to disease. Excess comfort leads to lethargy. Excess power leads to arrogance. Excess of anything only leads towards the bad. So, Lakshman tells Ram that whenever you do excess of anything, that excess leads to only bad things. And he actually tells Ram that there's a magic formula to recover Sita. And he tells him, instead of excess lamentation, right now what you need in your life is enthusiasm. There's a very interesting verse in the Niti which says, Ati rupena vai Sita, chati garvena ravana, ati danat balir baddho, ati sarvatra varjayet. This verse says, excessive beauty caused Sita to be kidnapped. Excessive arrogance caused Ravan to be slaughtered. Excessive charity caused Bali Maharaj to be bound up. And he says, so this verse says, excess of everything is bad. Of course, don't take the literal meaning of the verse. It's a more allegorical meaning which is important to learn. So, Lakshman is telling Ram that instead of lamenting too much, you should be enthusiastic to find your goal. He says, with enthusiasm, you can achieve any goal in life. Just be enthusiastic. Try enthusiastically to find Sita and we'll definitely find her. Here, Sita represents a living entity who got attracted to the golden deer. And as soon as her golden deer came into her life, Ram went away and she reached Lanka, which represents the material world. And Lanka is a land of materialism. She's surrounded by selfish people who are fanning her desires. And here, Ram is going through pain. What does that pain represent? That pain represents that when a living entity gets detached from the spiritual world and comes to the material world, this is the pain that God goes through in the spiritual world, in separation from the living entity. Now, what we see as a demonstration in the Ramayana of Ram crying for Sita is the exact same feeling that God has when each living entity, each one of us, have fallen down from the spiritual world to the material world. This is the exact same pain. So, apparently we might say, Hare, Ram is crying. What is the big deal? He's crying for Sita. He's actually crying for all of us also, by the way. It's not just Sita. He's crying for each one of us in the exact same way. And therefore, a human being needs to have 7 qualities in life to be able to achieve anything in life. The first quality that a human being needs to have is dhyana. Dhyana means focus. Don't sway away from the goal. The second is sakaratmakata, which means always think positive, always think good. Never allow the negativity inside you to manifest, to come in between your goals. The third is enthusiasm, utsaha. Tie everything that comes on your way to your dream. Have a dream, and everything that comes on your way, tie it to the dream. And then you'll be able to focus. The fourth thing is dhridata. Dhridata means grit or determination. Enthusiasm is not enough. The enthusiasm has to be sustained. And that's what is known as grit or determination. The fifth thing is, all this is important, but more important than all this is niswartha. That means a human being needs to be selfless. It's not only about me. It's about what I can do for others also. And then kritagyata, which means gratitude, even to those who make fun of us. Because when somebody makes fun of us, they're actually giving us a chance to prove ourselves. And finally, the seventh thing is jigyasu, which means the ability to ask questions. So instead of doubts, you need to have inquisition or questioning. Doubts close the door to success, but inquisitivity opens it. And therefore, we find that here, Ram is going through great lamentation, and Lakshman is telling Ram, this is not the time to be lamenting. This is the time to add enthusiasm into your life. So here, the scene below is of encouragement. And on top, the scene is of great lamentation, or rather frustration, fear, anxiety. At that point, something interesting happens in the Ramayana. This is the introduction of Hanumanji in the Ramayana. Hanumanji's entry happens with a very interesting way. Hanumanji's first statement in the Ramayana. This is a historical statement. You know what Hanumanji's first words of Hanumanji? He says, Sambrama tejatam esha bayam na yah asti. He tells Sugriv and all the other monkeys, don't worry, there is no fear in this mountain. Can you imagine what a dramatic way to enter the Ramayana? You know, what a way for a hero to enter. How does Hanumanji enter? He enters by giving hope to others. Hanumanji is telling, the first words of Hanumanji is, don't worry, there is no fear here. Tell me one thing, aren't we all looking for someone who can tell us that? Don't worry, there's nothing to worry. There's no anxiety. There's nothing to worry here. This is the role of Hanumanji all through his life. Why do you think people chant Hanuman Chalisa? Bhut pishacha nikat nahi. People chant Hanuman Chalisa because by chanting Hanuman Chalisa, they get actually great hope. When somebody is there to tell you, don't worry. And that's the role that each one of us have to play in somebody else's life at least. At least in one person's life, we should be able to say, don't worry, I'm there for you. You know, I mean, you may expect 100 people to do that for you, but you should be able to do it at least for one more person. And that's what Hanumanji signifies in the Ramayana. So as Hanumanji with a thunderous voice, he's telling this, all the four monkeys who are despondent and in great fear, turn towards Hanumanji and look at, you know, who is speaking this. And behind they see the huge, powerful personality of Hanumanji standing with his hand on his hip, powerful body, really great confidence in himself. And if Hanumanji wearing a golden dhoti and his top is bare except with ornaments on his chest, all of them enthusiastically, simultaneously, they start, you know, taking the name of Hanuman. Hanuman tells Sugriv, there is no fear of Vali on this mountain. And as soon as Hanumanji tells this, as long as we are by your side and the curse of Matanga Rishi favors you, Vali cannot touch you. Vali cannot harm you on this mountain. So as when Hanumanji says this, Sugriva has a flashback. He starts remembering all those incidents, very interesting incidents that happened on top of the Rishimukha mountains. So Sugriva is on this mountain, Rishimukha mountain, because he knows that this is the only place in the entire world where Vali cannot touch him. And Vali can touch him anywhere, kill him anywhere else, except on this mountain, because he has got a curse by Matanga Rishi that if he enters this mountain, he will die. Sugriva is on this mountain. But that doesn't stop Vali from troubling him. So Vali does something very interesting. So Vali, he has this ritual of every day doing Gayatri in four oceans, three times a day. So that means he jumps across from one ocean to another, you know, four times within that one Gayatri period. I mean, it's quite a distracted mind actually, you know. Who does jumping Gayatri, you know? You sit in one place and do Gayatri focused. But Vali was just all over the place, you know. Little he would do here and then little he would do there and then little. So he was jumping from one ocean to another, you know. And interestingly, every time he would jump from one ocean to another, in between he would give Sugriva a flying kick and go. Can you imagine what a destructive Gayatri he was doing, you know? Destructive, distracted Gayatri, you know. So he was jumping from one ocean to another. In between, he would land on Sugriva's head and then go ahead, you know. So technically, he didn't land on the Rishimukha mountain. So Matanga Rishi's curse doesn't work. But he hits Sugriva on his head. So literally 12 times a day, Sugriva would get beaten on his head by Vali, kicked on his head by his brother, you know. You can imagine what a torture it is. And Sugriva knew when that kick was coming also. Because Gayatri was very timed to perfection, you know. And Sugriva would be waiting for the kick because he had no option, literally, you know. Vali would definitely find him and kick him and then go ahead, you know. This was part of his sadhana, you know. One day, something interesting happened. So Sugriva, he got kicked and he was, because when the kick would come, he would start holding his head because, you know, you have to bear the pain. One day, just when the kick was going to come, and he was going to experience that excruciating pain on his head, suddenly, nothing happened. Sugriva was wondering what happened. And then he saw Vali was hanging in the air, just 1 inch above his head. His leg was right 1 inch above Sugriva's head, but he was not kicking him still. That's when Sugriva saw that somebody had caught Vali's both legs. This is Hanumanji. Hanumanji had caught both the legs of Vali right above Sugriva's head. Now Sugriva was wondering who has the power to hold Vali's legs like that, you know. That is an introduction of Hanumanji in Sugriva's life, actually. So till that point of time, Sugriva did not know Hanuman at all. And this was the way Hanuman entered into Sugriva's life. And, you know, when Sugriva saw with awe and reverence that somebody had caught this fellow's leg, Vali also saw him, of course. Now, Vali, he began to panic. Because Hanumanji started doing something very interesting. Hanumanji started dragging him towards the mountain. And Vali realized what's going to happen next, you know. He started shouting and screaming and he was totally helpless. And he started begging Hanumanji to leave him somehow or the other, you know. Hanumanji told him that, I'll leave you on one condition. The condition is that if you ever come back to this mountain or anywhere in the vicinity of this mountain, then I'll drag you onto the mountain and I will destroy you. Of course, Vali, you know, agreed to his condition. Hanumanji left him. Vali breathed a sigh of relief. He left from there. But in his heart, he carried great hatred towards Hanumanji from that point onwards. So Hanumanji, after that, he remained with Sugriva all through. And he became an advisor, he became a friend, he became a servant, he became a minister to Sugriva. And every time Sugriva was in trouble, Hanumanji spoke words that inspired him, that really, motivated him and gave him a lot of hope. There are two types of people in this world. There are Vali-like people who push others downwards. And there are Hanuman-like people who pull others upwards. Hanuman, whenever Sugriva was in trouble, he was there by his side to give him hope. When a person has a disturbed mind, he actually doesn't need advice. He needs hope. Generally, what happens when people have disturbed minds, everyone comes to give advice. You know, everyone comes to give expert advice. The fellow with a disturbed mind doesn't have the ability to handle advice. What he needs is somebody who can tell him, don't worry. There is hope in life. That's all. So Hanumanji starts advising Sugriv, rather giving hope to Sugriv, and telling Sugriv that, my dear Sugriv, remember that you're the son of the sun god. There is great expectation from you as a future leader. You're going to be the leader of all the vanaras, the monkeys. And when you are trembling in fear over here of your brother, you are showing yourself to be like an ordinary monkey. He said, the more petty-mindedness you exhibit, the smaller you'll remain in your own eyes. And if you are small in your own eyes, how can you become big in the eyes of others? And Hanumanji tells Sugriv, the body language of a king reveals the mindset of a king. He tells him that take charge of your mind and focus. So Hanumanji, generally, he never advised Sugriv. Generally, he would do the role of being a servant, being a minister, being a messenger. He wouldn't do this role of advising him all the time. Once in a while, Hanumanji spoke up. And whenever he spoke up very sensitively and very calculatedly. Because he knew that he didn't want to supersede the relationship. Hanumanji, then he studies Ram and Lakshman who are below. So till this point of time, Taru, Neela, Nala, they have done their study of Ram and Lakshman. And they come to the conclusion that Sugriv is in trouble. And Sugriv himself has seen Ram and Lakshman. He understands that definitely he is in trouble. Now Hanumanji is going to observe Ram and Lakshman. Sugriv tells Hanumanji, just one look at these two people brings great fear in my heart. Look at the way these people are. There is contradiction in their personality. He says, their attire and their weapons don't match. They are wearing attire of sadhus, but they are holding weapons of kshatriyas. So he says, they are dressed like, they look like princes, but they are dressed like sages. So he says, whenever there is high incompatibility, that indicates that there is a high controversy in thinking. So Sugriva has made his own conclusions about who Ram and Lakshman are. So Hanumanji, he looks now from his perspective, and just by looking at these two people, he is so attracted to them and he makes some very interesting conclusions. He has not spoken to them. He has not met them. He doesn't know them. He's just observing them. And just by observing them, he's making so many conclusions. Very accurate. He says, just by looking at them, I can make out both of them have a disturbed mindset. Their mind is very disturbed. And he says, they are both very fatigued after long walks. And they are pushing themselves ahead because they are searching for something valuable. They have lost something valuable. And he says, just looking at their body, from every pore of their body, dharma is oozing out. And they appear to be the most virtuous people. And looking at the luster, they almost appear like gods. And he says that these people, they appear to be oceans of mercy, Karuna Sagar. And he says, they are not people who are going to act and who are going to indulge in acts of violence for their own pleasures. And they're definitely not going to do anything adharmic. Sugriv, he calms down by hearing Hanumanji's words. And Sugriv tells Hanumanji, I understand what you're saying, but for me to believe you, I need tangible proof. He tells Hanumanji, change your appearance and go to them in the form of a sannyasi. Wear the robes of a sannyasi, disguise yourself as a sannyasi, change your form as a sannyasi and go to them and find out who they are. He tells Hanumanji how to find also, how to find out who they are. He tells them, use praise. Whenever anybody is praised a lot, they open their heart. So he tells them, tells Hanumanji, go and praise them a lot. Immediately they will open their heart to you. You know? Ramayana has a lot of diplomacy, right? He has a lot of insights about life, you know. I'm sure you can try it out with some people. You know? Somebody is not opening a heart, go and praise that person, you know. See if that person opens the heart. So he tells them, he tells Hanumanji, when you're talking to the two of them, make sure you're facing me constantly. He's way below. The two of them are way below. He tells him that when you're talking to the two of them, you keep looking at me. You keep facing me. So he tells, Sugriv tells Hanumanji, just by looking at your facial expressions, I will understand whether I should run or no. You know? So he tells, if I know that something is wrong, I'll run away from beginning only. I'll have at least a, you know, headway. So then Hanumanji immediately changes himself, changes his appearance, and he leaves from there. As I said, Hanumanji's entry in the Ramayana is to give hope to others. To live is to live fearlessly. There's no point in living in great fear. That's not life at all, you know. So, in this particular section, we find that whenever there is great ego and pride, somewhere around the corner there is tears also. We find that Vali had great ego and great pride in himself. But he had to cry at some point when Hanumanji held his feet. Anyone who exhibits ego and pride, somewhere down the line, there is going to be tears waiting in that person's life. Vali showed his power for too long. But at some point, he had to cry in his life. Hanumanji represents those people. As I was saying, the comparison between Vali and Hanumanji, Vali represents those people who push others down to show that they are great. And Hanumanji represents those people who pull others up. They are not there to prove their greatness, but actually they help others feel great. Look at the way Hanumanji is inspiring Sugriv in his state of hopelessness. One time, there was a boy who had a very poor mother. And no matter how much money they had or how much food they had in their house, the mother had a very interesting habit. Half of the food that they earned every day, they had every day, she would give it away in charity. Half of the food. The son was so irritated and so upset with his mother. He would think, you know, what nonsense. If half the food every day she gives it away in charity. So he went and asked his mother one day that, you know, I mean, why do you do this? Why do you give half the food away in charity? The mother tells him that I'm a simple woman. I'm an ignorant woman. I don't have answer to your question. Go and ask God. So this fellow, he says, okay, I'm going to go and ask God why my mother gives half the food in charity, you know. So he sets up, he's on a journey. On the way, he meets a king. And this king has built a huge tank. Water body. He's built a huge tank, but it is completely dry. So the king tells this boy, if you are anyway going to meet God, you ask this one question, why is my tank empty? Son says, okay, anyway, I have one question to ask. I'll ask a second question also. On the way, he meets a snake. The snake is stuck in a hole. And it's stuck in such a way that it can't go in also, it can't come out also. The snake tells him, go and ask God why I'm stuck in the hole like this, you know. This fellow says, okay, I'll ask. And then he goes further and he comes across a tree. And this tree is unable to produce any fruits. The tree asks him, go and ask God why I'm not able to have fruits. This fellow says, okay, I'll ask. And then finally he comes across a man whose legs are crippled by paralysis. And again, this man tells him, go and ask God why my legs are crippled. So he goes with all these problems and goes to, you know, God and asks him. You know, the God is in a very relaxed mood. And he asks him that, you know, I came across so many people who have so many problems. Do you have answers to all these questions? God said something very simple. He said, each one of them is keeping something to himself. That's why they're going through this problem. Tell them to give it away, their problem will get over. The boy said, what should I tell them to give away? So he said, the king has a young daughter whom he loves. He's so attached to her, he doesn't want to get her married only. Tell him to get her married and then, you know, his water tank will get filled immediately. And then he says, the snake has a jewel on its hood. Tell the snake to give the jewel and it'll get free. And then he says that the paralytic, the person who has a paralysis in his leg, he has some knowledge which he is hoarding. Tell him to give away the knowledge, he will immediately become free. And then he says the tree is hiding a treasure in its roots. Tell the tree to give away the treasure, it will immediately have fruits. So when this boy went and told each one of them the problem, each one of them gave him only the thing, you know. The tree gave this fellow only the jewels. The snake gave him the diamond. The king gave him the daughter, you know, in marriage. And the boy, that man, he gave all the knowledge to him, you know. And the moment he got all this, he came back home and he told his mother, I know why you're giving away half the food in charity. Because you have given so much, we have received so much. This is life. For most people who are like Vali, they are interested in taking things from others forcibly. But people like Hanumanji, they live a life of giving others enthusiastically and they get much more in return. Here is something that happens in Hanumanji's life, which is the greatest gift that Hanumanji receives. So now, Ram and Lakshman are walking around the Rishimukha mountains and suddenly they come across a dwarf sannyasi with a begging pot in one hand and a supporting stick in one hand. Very old, fragile looking sannyasi. As soon as they saw this elderly sannyasi, immediately the first question in Ram's mind was, what is a beggar doing in a forest? Now, beggars, you go to a place where there is lot of you know, people to beg, right? You don't go to a forest to beg for food or wealth or whatever you want. I mean, what would a beggar do? It doesn't fit to the job profile of the beggar, you know. It's the wrong location for the job, basically. Interestingly, Hanumanji and Ravan both took the form of a sannyasi. And the interesting part was, why did they take the form of a sannyasi? Because people tend to trust somebody who's dressed as a sannyasi instantly. But interestingly, both of them, when they took the form of a sannyasi, they retained their original mood. When Ravan took the form of a sannyasi, he took the form of a Parivajakacharya sannyasi. Parivajakacharya sannyasi are typically those who have hundreds of disciples, they have huge mutts of their own, they have a lot of property, and they're like very well established people, you know. So they dressed also very opulently. And when Hanumanji took the role of a sannyasi, he became a beggar sannyasi who doesn't know where the next meal is going to come from. So even in disguising himself as a sannyasi, Ravan had pride. And even in disguising himself as a sannyasi, Hanumanji had humility. So no matter what you disguise yourself, your original quality won't go away. It will be very visible and very obvious, you know. So when Hanumanji came across Ram and Lakshman, the first look at Ram's face, Ram's personality, suddenly something happened in Hanumanji's body. He began to shiver. Tears began to flow from his eyes. Practically every bone in his body seemed to be melting. Now he didn't understand what's happening to him. Why is he having these kind of experiences, you know? I mean, if a modern scholar of today's century had to study this, what happened to Hanumanji, probably they will call this as epilepsy, you know. Probably they'll term this as something like that, you know. He got an epileptic attack, you know, fit or something like that. But in the Vedic culture, we understand it to be ecstasy, you know. I don't mean that every epilepsy is ecstasy, but I mean that this particular thing is ecstasy, you know. I mean, don't quote me saying that, arey, isko ecstasy ho raha hai, you know. If you admit him in the hospital or somebody is going through it. So Hanumanji was, he went through something that he never ever experienced in his life. Practically felt every bone of his body melting. And then finally, when he became a little more stable, he went into their direction and he offered them respectful obeisances. Ram was instantly thinking, why would a sannyasi offer respects to young warriors? It didn't make sense to Ram, you know. So Hanumanji begins to talk to Ram. He asks him that y'all both seem to be a complete misfit in this forest. What is the purpose for which y'all are here? And he looks at Ram and he tells him that your hand is so long. And he tells that your shoulders are worthy of being decorated by precious ornaments. He asks him, why have you not decorated, why have you not covered this shoulder of yours? So Ram's one shoulder was exposed and one shoulder was covered. So Hanumanji asks him, why is your right shoulder left open and exposed to the elements? Ram was thinking, what kind of question somebody is asking him? I mean, you meet somebody, you don't ask these questions, you know, why you didn't wear clothes on this shoulder, why you didn't put ornaments on this shoulder, why you didn't cover it? And you don't ask such questions to strangers, right? You know, especially in today's times, definitely not. You know. Ram didn't answer, just kept quiet. Ram was thinking that everything seems to be out of place. Hanumanji introduces himself. He said, I'm a beggar who's asking alms. Please tell me what your identity is. Ram asked him, if you're a beggar, what is a diamond necklace doing on your neck? So now, Hanumanji's eyes practically come out of his socket. He's not able to believe what he just heard. He asks Lakshman, can you see the diamond necklace? Lakshman says, no, I can't see any diamond necklace. Hanumanji falls at the feet of Ram and starts crying. He holds the feet of Ram and he actually surrenders himself completely at that moment. Because behind this episode is a big story that only Hanumanji knows. When love leads to respect, it is called admiration. And when respect leads to love, it is called as inspiration. Love awakens naturally when you feel inspired to love somebody. In this particular questioning of Hanumanji, there is a very devotional element to it. According to Hanumanji, ornaments and clothes are not meant to enhance the beauty of the Supreme Lord. They're actually meant to cover his beauty. So just generally, you know, the understanding is ornaments increase the beauty of some person, right? Why do people buy all kinds of ornaments? Speaking of Nirav Modi and all that, you know. Why do people buy so many ornaments? Because when you wear ornaments, your beauty increases. But the understanding from a devotional element, devotional point of view is that when you wear ornaments, when the Supreme Lord has worn ornaments and worn clothes, the beauty decreases. Without any ornaments, the Lord is more beautiful. But because the devotee, he feels that, you know, nazar nahi lagna chahiye Bhagwan ko. Kapda dal dete. Thoda kam karne ke liye. To decrease the beauty a little bit, you know. So Hanumanji is asking Ram, why did you leave that shoulder open, you know? People will go mad looking at that open shoulder, you know. So Hanumanji, he is in this mood of respecting, loving. Suddenly all kind of respect comes out, all kind of veneration comes out from Hanumanji, because this is the kind of personality that Ram is. Extracts love from the heart. There's a story behind how Hanumanji got that jewel, got that necklace on his neck. The story is a story where when Hanumanji is a small child and he is with his mother, Anjani, at one point his mother leaves him and she goes away to attend other things and he feels hungry. And then he's looking for something to eat, and his mother has told him that, you know, fruits are red in color, that red fruits you can eat, you know. And he finds the sun, it's a massive red fruit. He jumps towards the sun to catch it. And as he's jumping towards the sun, as he's flying towards the sun, he goes and eats up the sun, holds the sun within his own mouth. And then the Rahu planet is attacking the sun. This is supposed to be a lunar eclipse at the exact same time. So generally, lunar eclipse is the time when Rahu eats up the sun. But here, the sun is already eaten by somebody else, you know. So Rahu comes and he's wondering, you know, what am I supposed to eat now, you know. So Hanumanji looks at Rahu, he's a huge black planet. Hanumanji thinks it's another fruit, black fruit. And he eats Rahu also. So Hanumanji has two chocolates in his mouth, you know. Sun on one side and Rahu on the other side, you know. And there's a universal calamity. There's darkness everywhere. And all the demigods go to Indra and tell him, please save us. So Indra comes out and he comes on sitting on the Airavat elephant. And when Hanumanji sees his white, huge Airavat elephant, he thinks it is another white fruit and he jumps on it. And Indra throws the Vajra and it hits Hanumanji on his chin. And Hanumanji falls unconscious. And as he's falling unconscious, his father Vayu picks him up and takes him into a cave. But Vayu withdraws all the wind from the world, from the universe. Now people are... First sun was missing, now wind is missing, you know. So all the demigods headed by Brahma, they go and they go to Vayu with his son. And they tell Vayu that, don't worry, we'll revive your son. Just let the air go, you know. So the father allows the air to go and all the demigods start blessing Hanumanji. And of all the blessings, there are so many blessings that come. Brahmaji, he blesses Hanumanji that you will have a long life. You will live as long as I live, you know. Agni gives him immunity from all kinds of fire hazards. His father Vayu gives him speed. Yamaraj gives him perfect health and everlasting youth. Kuvera gives him victory in every battle, small or big. Varuna gives him, you know, resilience from all water bodies. Vishwakarma gives him protection from all kinds of weapons. Surya gives him unsurpassed wisdom and also the ability to change form at will. Dhanvantri gives him the healing touch. So like that, different demigods give him different names and different benedictions. And then finally, Brahmaji gives him one very interesting boon. He gives him this diamond necklace. And he puts this diamond necklace on Hanumanji's neck and tells him that this is a special diamond necklace that nobody will be able to see. Can you imagine you wearing a necklace that nobody can see? Yeah. What a loss, you know. I mean, who would wear it? And why would you want to wear it? But Brahmaji gave him this necklace and told him a very interesting thing. He told him, no one will ever be able to see this necklace except one person. And the person who sees this necklace, you should surrender your life to that person. So can you imagine? Hanumanji was wearing this necklace all his life. Nobody ever saw it, including his own father and mother. No one ever saw the necklace. And the first person who saw the necklace was Lord Ram. And therefore, you know, he was shocked to know that Ram actually saw that necklace. Because he didn't have to bother about hiding it because nobody ever saw it. Lakshman didn't see it. And therefore, this necklace that is on Hanumanji's neck represents something very important in life. A fool does not see the scene. What is seen, a fool cannot see it. It's very, what is obvious also he can't see. Intelligent person sees the scene. A genius sees the unseen. But God sees both seen and unseen. As soon as Ram came in front of him and he spotted that necklace, the disguise that Hanumanji was wearing, you know, he had changed his form actually. Not just disguise. It is not like the drama, you know, you put a beard and everybody understands who it is, you know. It is not like that. He had actually changed his appearance. Hanumanji had actually changed his appearance completely. But the moment he recognized his master, his appearance faded away and he assumed his regular form. Essentially, for when you come in front of somebody really genuine, when you come in front of somebody very, very powerful spiritually, you can't hide your imitations. Your disguises are go away on its own, you know. All your disguises can stand in front of the whole world. But when you come in front of somebody who is worth giving your life to, that's not the place to show your disguises, you know. Your disguises automatically go away. The firefly can imitate the sun in darkness. But as soon as the sun rises, you know, the firefly becomes immediately humble, you know, becomes insignificant. That necklace on Hanumanji's neck represents something very important. Each one of us have some good qualities in us, some special qualities in us. Unfortunately, nobody can recognize those qualities. Somebody has to come into your life and point out to you what your good quality is. Each one of us are like Hanuman, wearing the diamond necklace around our neck all our life. We can't see it, nobody can see it, you know. Even our own parents can't see it most of the times. And that is when somebody like Ram comes into your life and points out, this is the quality you should work your life around. And the moment that person points out the quality, you immediately recognize it. You immediately know it is there. But unfortunately, for us to find that one Ram in our life, it takes us a whole lifetime sometimes, you know. Sometimes people find that Ram at the end of their life. I know people who have come into the Hare Krishna movement at the age of 80, 70s, you know. Ram ko dhoondte bhatak rahe jeevan bhar. But you need, each one of us need at least one person who can point out that quality. And that quality, the moment we spot it, we immediately understand what the purpose of our life is. Beauty is not just, doesn't just arise by ornamentation. There's a very beautiful verse on the Niti which says, Narasya abharanam rupam, rupasya abharanam gunam, gunasya abharanam jnanam, jnanasya abharanam shama. This verse says, the narasya abharanam rupam means the ornament of a human being is beauty. Then it says, rupasya abharanam gunam. The ornament of a beautiful person is good qualities. And then it says, gunasya abharanam jnanam. The ornament of somebody who has good qualities is knowledge. Because knowledge without good qualities does not survive. Without knowledge, good qualities don't survive. And jnanasya abharanam shama, which means the ornament of knowledge is forgiveness. If somebody is really knowledgeable, that means that person should have the ability to forgive. One who has bhakti in his heart, devotion in his heart, shama or forgiveness is automatic. Hanumanji was not really beautiful in that sense from an external point of view. But the next section of the Ramayana is called Sundarakand. Why is it called Sundarakand? It's called Sundarakand because the Sundar is not the external beauty of Hanumanji, but the beautiful qualities of Hanumanji that Ram recognized. And therefore, the next whole book, or the entire book, is about only Hanumanji. In this book, at least there are 3-4 other personalities hanging around, you know. But in the next book, there is no one except Hanumanji. And therefore, that book is called Sundarakand. So, when we try to connect with God, the immediate thing is that those good qualities start manifesting in us. There is a very nice verse in the Niti which says, Guna dosha budo grinan, Induk swadav iva ishwara, Shirasha slagate purvam, Param kanthe niyachati. This verse says, although a saintly person sees good and bad in others, but a saintly person focuses on the good, speaks the good qualities, and keeps aside the bad qualities and keeps the faults only in the mind. And the example that this verse gives is, just like Lord Shiva holds the moon on his head but keeps the poison in his throat. So similarly, a saintly person speaks the good qualities of a person openly but holds the faults within himself. So when somebody sees somebody having good qualities, instantly there is glorification. So Hanumanji connects with Lord Ram very intensely, surrenders his life to Lord Ram. And Ram asks him, who are you? This is the first conversation that Ram is having with Hanuman. I mean, can you imagine the master and the servant are united together, and the first discussion, first question that Ram is asking Hanuman, who are you? Hanuman says, I am a servant of Sugriva. The first meeting, first impression is bad impression, you know. The moment Hanumanji says, I am servant of Sugriva, Ram steps aside. He allows Lakshman to come in the front and talk to Hanumanji. Interestingly, the next 4 months, Ram and Hanumanji don't have any discussion at all. Ram avoids talking to Hanumanji for 4 months because of this one mistake that Hanumanji made. Hanumanji, it takes him 4 months to rectify the wrong impression that he gave on Lord Ram. Therefore, when you come in front of saintly people, you have to be careful what you speak, you know. I know so many people, when they come in front of exalted saintly people, they just speak nonsense. They speak nonsense, utter nonsense. What is the point in going in front of a saintly person and giving a visiting card, you know, and telling, I am so and so. What is the point in talking about your qualification? What is the point in talking about your greatness? What is the point in talking about your bank balance? All this doesn't make any sense to a saintly person. What you're supposed to introduce yourself as, you know, Hanumanji is introducing himself, I'm servant of Sugriv. He's supposed to say, I'm servant of Ram. Instead of saying servant of Ram, he's saying, I'm servant of Sugriv, you know. The moment he said, I'm servant of Sugriv, Ram said, okay, you deal with my servant now, you know. He said, servant deal with servant, I will deal with your master, you know. So Ram stepped aside. Instantly, Hanumanji understood he made a mistake. Some people, after making mistake also, they don't understand. That is the problem. Yeah. Making mistake is not a problem. But after you make the mistake, you should at least have the ability to understand that you made a mistake. Some people are so insensitive, they don't understand even after making repeatedly same mistake. Yeah. So, of course, internally, Ram was very impressed with Hanumanji. So he and Lakshman were having a conversation privately. They were like, you know, whispering into each other's ears, whatever they were feeling. So Ram was telling Lakshman, if this is the quality of the servant, what must be the quality of a master? He is saying, just by meeting Hanuman, I am convinced that Sugriva is the right person to help us find Sita. And then the conversation between Hanuman and Ram takes place. Sorry, Hanuman and Lakshman takes place. So Hanumanji introduces himself, introduces Sugriva. Lakshman tells the whole history of who they are, where they have come from, and what they are going through in their lives, and what they need help for. So as they're having this conversation, Ram is constantly observing Hanuman. And Hanuman is looking at Ram. Hanuman, when he looks at Ram, he has two thoughts on his mind. He has two analogies in his mind that immediately come to him. He felt that Ram is a combination of sweetness of honey and the sharpness of a sword. Generally, a person can be sweet, or he can be sharp. Here he says he's sharp also and he's sweet also, you know. Most people are either sharp or sweet. Those who are sharp, they cannot be sweet, definitely. They cut, you know, very badly. And those who are sweet, they cannot be sharp. They're too sweet to be sharp, you know. So he says, Hanumanji says, he's sharp like a sword and he's sweet like honey. Because he finds that Ram is a person who can protect, at the same time nourish. Only God can do that. Everybody else can do one of the two things, you know. They can't do both. Lakshman, as he is conversing with Hanumanji, and Hanumanji is explaining the whole situation to them, Hanumanji realizes that Sugriva is in the exact same situation as Ram, and both can help each other. Hanuman is typically, the role that Hanuman does in the Ramayana is that of uniting people. Throughout the Ramayana, you find Hanuman is a uniter. Unites Ram with Sugriv. Eventually, he unites Sita with Ram. And at so many events, unites Vibhishan with Ram. At so many levels, Hanumanji does this role of uniting, you know. In today's term, he's a good networking man, you know. Expert in connecting great people together. And what does he get out of it? Nothing. He loves to unite people. And that's the role that Hanumanji does throughout the Ramayana. So, Hanumanji glorifies Sugriva a lot. He talks about how Sugriva is the right person to help you all. In fact, the first impression that Ram gets about Sugriva is from Hanuman. Can you imagine? If Hanuman had told all the problems that Suri has, can you imagine what would have happened, you know? If he had said, Are Buddhu hai, Lallu hai, kuch malum nahi hai, rota rehta hai hamesha, you know? I mean, they're all facts, right? But rather than focusing on those facts, Hanumanji decided to focus on the good qualities of Sugriva. And because Hanumanji spoke those good qualities of Sugriva, Ram's first impression of Sugriva was great. Later on in the Ramayana, we find that when Hanumanji talks about Vibhishan, again he talks about all the good qualities of Vibhishan, you know. And because of that, Ram's first impression of Vibhishan was great. This is the beauty of people who are non-envious. This is the beauty of people who don't have jealousy and envy in the heart. This is the beauty of people who are beyond selfishness. They can openly glorify others. Those who carry envy in the heart, very difficult to open your mouth and genuinely appreciate somebody. You can flatter easily. Actually, flattery is also a manifestation of jealousy only. Because when you flatter, you don't really mean anything, you know. But to genuinely appreciate someone, you really need to be non-envious of that person, you know. So, Hanumanji told Ram and Lakshman about, you know, Sugriva's greatness. And Ram, he starts explaining to Lakshman, as he hears Hanumanji's speech, he tells Lakshman, this person is Vakya Kushala. That means he is expert in speech. Just by hearing Hanuman speak, I know what he has studied. He says, he has definitely studied the scriptures in depth from his exalted teachers. He says, not even a single flaw in either his speech or his body language from the moment we have spotted him. He says his words are unambiguous, consistency in speed and volume. Whatever he starts, the same speed he maintains till the end. And whatever volume he starts, the same volume he maintains till the end. And he says there is great stillness in his body, due to which the listener's attention is drawn towards him very easily. And there are some people, when they speak, they keep moving around, you know. You don't know what to focus on, you know, because he's moving so much, you know. So sometimes just being still and speaking, that helps to focus. And he says, Ram tells that he knows the art of utilizing various parts of the body, like the stomach, the palate, the nasal passage, to utter different words and to utter phonetics properly. And he says he has mastered the four Vedas. Natural humility is the result of studying Atharva Veda. Just by hearing his words and his gestures, you understand that this person has studied Atharva Veda properly. And he says his vocabulary and his choice of words shows that he has great power of retention. And that power of retention comes by studying Yajurveda. And he says that he remembers complex details by memory because of Yajurveda study. And he says the knowledge of Rig Veda that he has gives him the ability to reproduce everything he has learnt. Definitely Hanuman has learned Rig Veda also. And he says that, look at the voice, the charm and the suppleness in his voice. Every word coming out from his mouth looks like a song. Definitely he has studied Samaveda properly, you know. And he says he's made no mistakes in words he chooses, no error in sentence formation. He can win anybody's heart just by speaking. And he says he can accomplish any mission just by his speech. And he says, Hanumanji's speech is so powerful that if somebody is angry and has a raised sword in his hand, just by hearing Hanumanji's speech, anger will go away. Ram is glorifying Hanumanji like anything. And he says, lucky is the king who has an expert messenger like Hanuman. And wherever Hanuman is, there will be success for sure. Eloquence in speech is the result of digested knowledge. There are many people who speak well, but when you speak without having digested knowledge, that speech doesn't touch your heart. It doesn't transform. It's not just about speaking. It's about how to speak, what to speak, when to speak, how much to speak, all that matters. There was one preacher who entered a hall to give a sermon, and hall was empty except one fellow was sitting in the front, you know. So this fellow was thinking, should I give the lecture or no? Because he had prepared very intensely, you know, like long lecture. So he went and asked that person in the front row, you know. He said, you know, I came prepared for a lecture, but I don't see anybody here, only you are there. What should I do? Should I speak or should I not speak? This fellow said, see, I'm a simple person. I don't understand all these things. But I know if I go to a stable, if I go to a, you know, a place where horses are kept, and if I find that all the horses ran away except one horse, I will still feed him. This fellow says, theek hai. So he got the answer. He went on, gave full-fledged lecture, 2 hours, you know, downloaded everything he knows, you know. And then after the whole thing, he said, how did you like my lecture? You know, this fellow said, see, I'm a very simple person. I don't understand all these things. But I know that if all the horses ran away and only one horse is there, I will not feed everything to that one horse, you know. Sometimes, you know, when people speak, they just love to speak so much. They just don't care for what that person's capacity is to handle it, you know. To be able to speak, you need to have some substance inside, you know. Like there was a story of during the British times, there was one person called Srinivas Shastri, great scholar, and the Britishers didn't like him at all, because whenever he would speak, people would be spellbound. So they called him once just to make fun of him. They called him for a lecture, and they didn't give the topic to him. When he reached over there, they gave him the topic. They said, your topic is nothing. That's all, nothing. He spoke 3 hours about nothing, you know. After 3 hours speaking about nothing, he concluded the whole talk by saying, without India, British is nothing. Very interesting, you know, person. Hanumanji conquered the Lord's heart just by his speech. And therefore, words that come out from your mouth show a lot about how much knowledge you have, what your education is, who your teachers are. It teaches a lot about so many things. Of course, people like you and me may not be able to understand all that. But when Lord Ram saw Hanumanji's speech, he could decipher every subject he has studied. Can you imagine what a detailed analysis this was? Hanumanji, he tells Ram and Lakshman, please allow me to carry you to Sugriv. So as Hanumanji is carrying Ram and Lakshman to Sugriv, Hanumanji is sharing, so he carries Ram and Lakshman on his shoulders to Sugriv. And on the way, he tells Ram and Lakshman the story of the birth of Sugriv, which is a very interesting story, you know. Of course, this story of the birth of Sugriv is not directly in the Valmiki Ramayana, but this is a Puran connected. So that's how these scriptures are, you know. The way I'm trying to narrate the Ramayana is, whenever there are backstories, I connect them into that place. Because now, without understanding that, the backstories, to be able to understand the Ramayana is almost impossible, you know. So when you understand all the backstories, this is where the character development comes. And where you understand every personality very well. So this story, so Hanumanji is narrating the story to Ram and Lakshman. And this story is about how at one point, there was one lady who was very angry with one sage. So there was a sage named Ugrashravas. So the story of Ugrashravas comes in the first Kanda, Balakanda of the Ramayana. Sorry, the Ayodhya Kanda of the Ramayana, the end of it. So there was one sage named Ugrashravas, and this sage, he gets angry on her husband. So this sage was meditating on a trishu, on a trident. There is one trident that pierces this sage because of some curse in the past. And this husband of this lady, Shilavati, her name is, he's walking, he's drunk, totally drunk, you know. And he trips on the sage. And when he trips, the spear really pierces the sage. And he gets so upset on this person that he curses him that you will die before sunrise. So this his wife, she becomes so angry on the sage that she curses the sun not to rise only. So that day, no sunrise. Can you imagine? What a way to have a holiday, you know? No sunrise. If you have sunrise only, you start your work, right? Sun doesn't rise only, what you will do? So that day was the first official holiday for the sun god. Means all of us have Sunday holiday at least, right? But sun god has no holiday on Sunday also. Though it is supposed to be his day, you know. So when the sun is not going to rise, what to do? So sun god and his assistant Aruna, you know, he decided, the Aruna told him, see, I'm sitting here all day long. I can't do anything. I have to, you know, keep doing my duty. Can I take a holiday today? Sun god said, do what you want, you know. So when typically you are too stressed out, what do? You go to do something that you have always imagined, right? He went straight to Swarga and he wanted to have fun. They have the rave parties in Swarga Loka, you know. So he said, let me just go and have fun, you know. Just forget all the stress and the work pressure and all that, you know. So he just ran into the heavens, but he realized that he doesn't have permission to enter the heavens in the form that he is. So he decided to disguise himself. And he took the form of a beautiful Apsara. And he called himself as Aruni. Aruna became Aruni. Beautiful looking Apsara. And he went into the heavens. All the gods in the heaven, they went crazy behind Aruni, you know. And everybody forgot Urvashi and Menaka and Ramba and all, they started running after Aruni, you know. This guy, he didn't expect that to happen, you know. Something really weird, you know. And holiday turning into a nightmare, you know. Something like that happened basically with Aruni, you know. And Indra told him, I want to marry you. Now, how is he going to explain that I'm not a girl, I'm a boy, you know. This is going through all kinds of complicated things. And then finally, Indra and Aruni united. In the heavens, everything is fast, you know. Instantly, they had a child. You know? Indra said, I can't handle the child. You take the child with you, you know. So Aruna, now he came back to the chariot, the sun god, with a baby in his hand, you know. Sun god said, Are, kidhar gaya? Bachche ko leke aa gaya wapas. And then he explained, you know, aisa ho gaya mere saath, you know. The sun god said, nah, I want to see that form, you know. He said, very risky. Khatarnak maamla hai. Sun god said, nothing doing, I want to see that form. He showed him that form. And the next moment they had another baby, you know. A sun god said, I can't take responsibility for this baby, you do what you want, you know. Now that's the problem with the heavens. They want enjoyment, want no responsibility. Sound similar? Yeah. So then now Aruna, now he had these two babies and they had to find somebody who can handle them. You know? And that's when they found this monkey king who took the responsibility of these two children. Now they had the power of the gods, but they had the form of the monkeys. And that was how Vali and Sugriva were born. Sugriva, the son of the sun god, and Vali, the son of Indra. Disguises have a lot of problems. Whenever you disguise yourself, it actually shows your intention. Here, Aruna, he wanted to have fun. He disguised himself. And instead of having fun, he had misery only, you know. So whenever you disguise yourself, not necessarily you're going to have fun. As long as you're comfortable with yourself, you can have fun. But the moment you try to become like somebody else, disguise yourself to be like somebody else, the fun element goes away. There's only pain when you try to imitate others. Not being comfortable with oneself is a disease in today's age. Somehow or the other, no one is comfortable with themselves. They want to be like somebody else. Abraham Lincoln, he was not a very good-looking person, you know. And somebody made a portrait of Abraham Lincoln. Now you can imagine, the president of the country, you make a portrait of him, you know, and he is not that good looking. What do? So this guy, he made a portrait that showed him to be like really handsome and really good looking. When Abraham Lincoln saw it, he said, it looks like you took ideas from my principles and not my person. That means he said, you painted not my face, but you painted my principles over there. That's why it looks so beautiful. He was comfortable with who he was. Many times, people are not so comfortable with who they are. And because they are not so comfortable with who they are, they try to show themselves to be somebody else. There was a very rich lady who spent a lot of money on makeup and some kind of plastic surgery and things like that. She went to George Bernard Shaw and she told him, can you tell me what my real age is? Do you know, what do you think is my age? He looked at the lady and he said, if I look at your teeth, you look like 18 years old. But if I look at your curly brown hair, it seems to be, you seem to be 19 years old. But if I consider your complexion, you seem to be 14 years old, you know. Now this girl, this lady was like flattered, totally flattered, you know. And she told him, I insist, please tell me what you think is my age. He said, I already told you, add the three numbers, you know. You'll get your, what do you think of my... So sometimes, when you try to be somebody else, all you get is pain because you're not comfortable with yourself. Interestingly, Hanumanji also had a very different type of birth. The story of Hanumanji's birth is a very inspiring story because the story of Hanumanji's birth is a story of sacrifices. The story of Aruna and, Sugriv and Vali's birth is a story of selfishness, is a story of lack of responsibility. The story of Hanumanji's birth is a story of selflessness and sacrifices. No wonder these three people are totally different in their natures, you know. So there's a lot of connection with birth. There's a lot of connection with your consciousness and upbringing. There's a lot of connection with the way you are and the way your self-image gets formed. So there was a demon whose name was Shambha Sadhana, and he was a very powerful demon. And he was destroying the sages and destroying civilization so much. At one point of time, Shambha Sadhana, he saw Anjana, who was the mother of Hanumanji, much before when she was a young girl. He saw her meditating on top of a mountain in a cave. Shambha Sadhana, as soon as he saw her, he wanted to marry her. But the moment she saw him, she pushed him away and she ran. So as she ran, she came across the sages. She wanted to find out from them, who's going to protect me from this demon who's chasing me? The sages told him, there's only one person who can protect you, and that is Keshari. But we have no idea where Keshari is. Keshari is one of the chiefs of the monkeys. Anjana was really in anxiety because Shambha Sadhana was just around the corner. And just the moment Shambha Sadhana reached over there, he was going to capture her, Keshari arrived on the scene. And then Keshari and Shambha Sadhana had a massive fight. And in the midst of this whole fight, Keshari had taken a small form and he was beating up Shambha Sadhana like anything. And the interesting part was, no matter how much Keshari was beating Shambha Sadhana, this demon was just not dying at all. There was blood splattered all over, but this demon is just not dying. And that's when the sages told this lady, told Anjana, that Shambha Sadhana is not going to die like this. So Anjana sat down, meditated on Lord Shiva, and instantly she found the answer to her question. She realized the only way this demon can be killed is by his own blood. So she took an arrow, dipped it into the blood of Shambha Sadhana, and she gave the bow and arrow to Keshari. And Keshari shot the arrow at Shambha Sadhana, and instantly Shambha Sadhana was dead. When Shambha Sadhana was killed, the sages, they glorified Keshari and they glorified Anjana a lot. And they told the two of them Both of y'all are meant to give birth to somebody powerful who's going to be the savior of the world. And they asked both of them to get married. And both Keshari and Anjana, that's how they came together. And eventually, after many, many years of being together, they do not having a child. That's when both of them decided they're going to purify themselves to prepare themselves for this child that is going to come. So Anjana went on top of a mountain. She was preparing herself. Keshari went to all the holy places. He was preparing himself. And then in the midst of all this, something happened in the Kailash mountains. In Kailash, Lord Shiva was meditating, closing his eyes. And as he was meditating, closing his eyes, thousands of followers sitting in front of him, suddenly he got up with a start, started chanting the name of Ram, 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 like that. People were completely bewildered because they had never heard Shiva chant that name ever in their life. And suddenly he's chanting the name of somebody whom they don't know. And then Shiva explained that very soon Vishnu is going to take an incarnation of Lord Ram, and I want to be available to assist him in this incarnation. He's going to come in the form of a human being. Therefore, I'm going to take the form of a monkey. Now, Parvati, who was standing next to him, she told him, if you are going to take the form of a monkey, I also want to become a she-monkey. Shiva said, see, this is a role which I'm going to do for serving Lord Ram. And for serving Lord Ram, I want no distractions. So in this role, I'm going to be a brahmachari, you know. No marriage. So Parvati said, see, no problem, don't get married, but let me become your tail. And therefore, Hanumanji's tail is Mother Parvati. Hanumanji is Lord Shiva, the 11th Rudra. And the tail of Hanumanji is Mother Parvati. Therefore, the tail has a life of its own, you know. It does its own stuff. This is Parvati's service to Lord Ram, basically. So, and that's how Hanumanji, so as soon as that happened, Shiva and Parvati took the form of monkeys. And they united. And the conception of Shiva was taken by the Saptarishis and put into a leaf, a metal, a leaf of five metals. And that conception was handed over to Vayu. And Vayu carried that conception and through the years of Anjana poured it. And that is how Anjana had Hanuman in her womb. Eventually, Hanumanji was born to Keshari and Anjana. And at some point in Hanumanji's life, he became a student of the sun god. He had great eagerness to study. And his father told him, the best teacher in the universe is Surya. So Hanumanji took admission in Surya's international school, you know, inter-universal school actually. Sun god was traveling around, and on the chariot, he had 60,000 sages whom Surya was teaching. Now, everyone does multitasking, even the sun god. He is roaming around all the time, but at the same time, he has a passion to teach, share knowledge. So he's extending himself. He's not saying, "Arey, mera ek hi duty hai, ghumna hai bas, aur kuch nahi karunga." Just see how much he's trying to extend himself to share. And when Hanumanji came over there and he told him, "I also want to study under you," he said, "I'm sorry, I don't have place in my school." You can see it's all, you know, every school seemed to be full, you know. Hanumanji says, "Don't worry, I don't need place, just give me permission, you know." So Hanumanji, he was flying along with Surya. Can you imagine what a student he was? Discomfort, no space, no AC, doesn't matter to him, you know. No chairs, doesn't matter to him. It was great eagerness to study. And Hanumanji was hearing every word Surya was telling. Not even once he asked him to repeat. Absorbed completely. And not just that, Surya was flying in one direction, Hanuman was flying in the backwards, just so that he can see the teacher's face. So you can imagine what kind of enthusiasm he had to study, you know. So if we have even a fraction of that enthusiasm, at least we won't sit in a, we won't sleep in an AC hall, you know. Seated in an AC hall, comfortable, at least we won't sleep. I'm not saying you're sleeping. I'm just saying we shouldn't. Hanumanji's eagerness to hear, enthusiasm to hear was beyond complaints. At the end of this whole education, The debt of gratitude to a guru can be never repaid in full. Guru Dakshina is a token amount of the EMI that has to be repaid every day of life through grateful memories. You know, Guru Dakshina is nothing but just like a token amount. It's not that you're repaying what the guru has given. You can never repay. So when he asked for Guru Dakshina, what Guru Dakshina did Surya ask? He said, "You become the assistant of my son Sugriv." Can you imagine what a role that is? Hanumanji can say, "Whoa, that duffer, you're asking me to be his assistant." Hanumanji didn't say all that. He just said, "Your will be done." Upadesh or instruction is the role of a teacher. Nirnay or choice is the role of a student. Hanumanji had a choice whether he wants to fulfill that gratitude or no, the Guru Dakshina or no, and he chose to do it. And therefore, Hanumanji became Sugriva's best friend. Here's a very interesting story about friendship. The mathematician Ramanujam, he was one of the greatest mathematicians in the history of the world. He didn't have much close friends. So somebody asked him, "Why you don't have so many friends? Why you don't have any friends at all, literally?" He said, "I always wanted a close friend, but nobody is up to my expectation." Now, then somebody asked him, "What do you expect from a friend?" He gave a very interesting answer. He said, "A friend should be like the number 220 and 284. This is a typical answer a mathematician gives, you know. Now, they didn't understand what is the meaning of 220 and 284. So he said, "Can you find out what is the divisors of number 220? So they found out these are the divisors of number 220. And he said, "What are the divisors of number 284? And, you know, they found out, great difficulty, this is the divisor of 284. He said, "Exclude the number 220 and 284 from this list and add all the numbers." They added it and they found all the divisors of 220, if you add it, it comes to 224. And all the divisors of 284, if you add it, it comes to 220. He said, "This is how a friend should be. A friend should be somebody who represents you. And you should be a friend who represents your friend." He said, "I have not found somebody like that. So I didn't have any friend." Hanumanji is one of those friends that not just represented his friend properly, but actually understood him completely. And only if you have somebody like Hanumanji in your life, you realize that life is so beautiful. Inside each one of us, there is a good side and an ugly side. Generally, the world is unfolding you inside out. And there are some people who play the role of Shakuni in your life, make the ugly side come out faster. And therefore, we need to find at least somebody who can play the role of Krishna in our life, who makes the beautiful side come out. Hanumanji brought Ram and Lakshman to Sugriv. And this was the first time Sugriv was meeting Ram and Lakshman. I'm going to end with this episode today. We've already gone 20 minutes beyond time, but we started late, so I'll go up to another 10 more minutes. So this episode of the Ramayana is actually a turning point in the Ramayana, because this is the meeting of Sugriv with Ram and Lakshman. And Hanumanji, he first goes to Sugriv without taking Ram and Lakshman, assures Sugriv that these two are not allies of Vali. And then Hanumanji, of course, when Hanumanji goes to Sugriv, he converts himself into a disguised form, in the beggar form, and he goes. Because, you know, Sugriv will think that he didn't follow his instructions. So Hanumanji is very clever. He goes, as you know, in the beggar form, and then he informs Sugriv what has happened, and then he brings Sugriv out. So when Hanumanji brings Sugriv out, introduces Ram and Lakshman to Sugriv, Sugriv does something very interesting. Sugriv puts out his hand to shake the hand of Ram. Can you imagine if God comes in front of you, what do you do? Shake hand. "Hello, how are you?" You know, "Hi." That's not how you greet God, right? Hanumanji was thinking, oh my God, what kind of a person? He should be holding his feet. He's holding his hand over here, you know. But Ram, he does something amazing. Ram holds his hand, shakes his hand, and pulls him and embraces him. Sugriva, when he's embraced by Ram, tears flow from his eyes. Because he's thinking, here is a stranger. First time I'm meeting him. And he's loving me as if he knows me so well. And there is my brother, my own brother. He's treating me worse than a stranger. That's something that really touches Sugriv's heart. And then Ram and Sugriv stare at each other for a long time. It's very interesting, the Ramayana talks about how Ram and Sugriv stare at each other for a long time. Sugriv staring at Ram for a long time makes sense because Ram is beautiful. But Ram staring at Sugriv, monkey, why would you stare at a monkey for a long time, you know? The understanding the Acharyas give us is that Sugriv represents that living entity that has gone away from God for a long period of time. And now is a turning point in Sugriv's life. The turning point in the living entity's life where the living entity is actually thinking of doing some seva to God. So Ram is looking at Sugriv, looking at him as a lost soul. Come back. So just like when a lost person, when a lost relative, lost friend, you meet that person after a long period of time, how do you, I mean, you keep on looking at that person for a long time, right? That's the mood that Ram is having when he's looking at Sugriv. And Hanumanji, he understands that right now Sugriv seems to be in a good mood. He is promising that he will, you know, be a friend. He will do everything to help him. But Hanumanji understands Sugriv is after all a monkey. Monkey's mind is very flickering, you know. Anytime it jumps here and there, you know. So Hanumanji, he does something to seal that friendship. He creates a fire. A sacrificial fire, and he tells Sugriv and Ram to take oath of friendship around that fire. Why do these rituals need to be done? Initiation, fire sacrifice, you know, the whole process of formal diksha and all that. Why all that? It's just to tell your monkey-like mind to remember its promise. In front of Guru, in front of deities, in front of so many devotees, in front of the fire, after all that, you take vows and then finally maybe your mind will be stable and follow it, you know. And here is not just a monkey mind, it is a monkey only, you know. So Hanumanji understands that this fellow needs proper commitments. And then Sugriv does something very interesting. So Sugriv calls Ram and Lakshman, you know, to his cave. And then he goes and brings a huge branch of a sal tree. And he offers it, puts it on the ground and asks Ram to come and sit on that branch. And Ram sits in one side of the branch and Sugriv goes and sits on the same branch. Hanumanji is looking at Sugriv. What nonsense. First of all, he didn't give any seat to Lakshman. Lakshman is standing wondering what to do now, you know. And Ram is so, well, he's completely disturbed that instead of giving seat to Lakshman, Sugriv went and sat next to him, you know. Hanumanji was feeling so bad that Lakshman is not treated properly. And on top of that, you don't sit on the same level as Ram, right? So Hanumanji, he decided, there's no point in teaching him something. Let me do something. So he went and got a branch of a better tree, of a sandalwood tree. And he put it on the ground, offered the seat to Lakshman, and he himself sat on the ground. He didn't sit on the same level, you know. He didn't say, Are ye dono raja hai, hum dono mantri hai, baju baju baithte hai, you know. Hanumanji was sensitive. And that was first impression of Ram about Hanumanji. Second impression, actually. Second good impression, you know. First of the words that Hanumanji spoke and the kind of language that he used. And here, the sensitivity of Hanumanji towards respecting Lakshman. So, when Sugriv, Ram and Lakshman were seated now, the whole discussion was going to start. Many times, we are all like Sugriv in our life. We have certain perceptions of what problems are. And sometimes, the perception that we have of the problem appears bigger than reality. Many problems, when perceived with clarity, result in freedom. But when perceived with fear, result in pain. Actually, many problems are camouflage solution for some other problem actually. Here, in this particular case, Sugriv felt Ram and Lakshman to be a problem. But actually, they were solutions to the problem of Vali. So, Sugriv was thinking they are problems, but they are actually solutions. The Lord here is teaching us how to extract honey from an extremely negative situation. A honeybee, no matter how what kind of flower it sits on, even if it sits on a neem flower, it extracts sweet honey. So similarly, all of us, even if we come across the most extremely negative situation, we should have the ability to extract honey from it. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna speaks about Mam Anusmara Yuddhacha. What is the meaning of Mam Anusmara Yuddhacha? Yuddhacha means fight. Mam Anusmara means remember me. Remember me and fight. That means in life, one should not just fight, but while fighting, remember God. That means honey. Mam Anusmara is honey. And Yuddhacha is problem. It's not just problem. Find honey within the problem. So we find that people who struggle a lot, they are the ones who grow a lot. Here in this whole story, we find Vali and Sugriv. They're brothers. They're both in different types of problems. But we find Ram connects with Sugriv and not with Vali. Why? There are many reasons which we will see tomorrow. But the essence of all the reasons is that Vali lived a very comfortable life, all his life. But Sugriv was the one who actually struggled a lot in his life. Sometimes struggle prepares you for dealing with a lot in life. Those who are living comfortable lives, when they come across problems in life, they don't know how to handle it. But when people have gone through challenges in life, when they come across problems, they may not have solutions, but they have the strength to handle problems, which is very, very important. In the Mahabharata, Dronacharya, when he was appointed as the commander-in-chief of the Kaurava army, on the very first day, he was defeated thoroughly by Arjun. Thoroughly. Duryodhan went to Dronacharya and asked him, "You are the guru of Arjun. He is your student. How the hell did he defeat you? Why are you not able to defeat him?" Dronacharya said, "You're right. He is my student. I know every trick that he knows. In fact, I only taught him every trick that he knows. But the difference between him and me is that he has struggled a lot in his life. I have lived a life in the palace of luxury and comfort." And he said, when he struggled, with that struggle, he has developed more wisdom and strength than me. In life, sometimes when you go through struggles, those struggles gives you certain strength that nobody else can give you. People like Hanumanji are people who can help us recognize that honey within that fight that we are going through in life. People are like Hanumanji are the ones who can help us recognize the nectar within all our problems. Hanumanji was a great teacher who recognized godliness where they seem to be none. Essentially, when Sugriv saw Ram and Lakshman, he saw them as problems. But when Hanumanji saw Ram and Lakshman, he saw them as God come to solve his problems. And that is perception. And that is the way a great teacher helps us deal with problems that we come in life. When someone is convinced of the existence of God, he can see the hand of God in every situation of life. There was one atheist. he was constantly arguing with one lady, very simple devotional lady, that God doesn't exist. And this lady, no matter what argument he would give, she was convinced that God existed. So one day he decided to prove that God doesn't exist logically. So he went in front of her house when this lady was inside. He put a lot of grocery in front of her house. And he went and hid behind a tree, you know. She opened the house and she saw there was so much grocery. And she started saying, "Thank God for supplying so much." This fellow jumped out and he told her, "You are saying God supplied, I paid all the bill." This lady says, "God, you are so great. You not only sent the supply, but you made the atheist pay the bill also." You know? Sometimes, when you have faith, even when there is godlessness, you can see God. When you don't have faith, even when there is display of godliness, you can see godlessness. Here, Hanumanji is that person who tried to teach us a way of seeing life.